Welcome to the course Life Insurance Mathematics. I am Jan Dane and I will teach the theoretical part of this course. This course will be based on the book Actuarial Mathematics for Life Contingent Risks, written by David Dixon, Mary Hardy and Howard Waters. We will consider the third edition, which was published in 2020. In this video, we'll have a look at the second chapter, chapter 2, about survival models. We will not really talk about life insurance already in this chapter, but we will look how we can model in a stochastic way survival of people. In this chapter 2, we will consider the future lifetime random variable. We will define all kinds of probabilities related to death and survival of individuals. We will define the important concept of the force of mortality. We will introduce some basic actuarial notation. And then finally, we will also talk about the Curtit future lifetime random variable. Consider a person aged X today, now that we observe him. We will call such a person aged X, we will call that a status X, and we will denote that by X between brackets. The future lifetime of the status X is of course a random variable and will be denoted by Tx. We will always assume that Tx is a continuous random variable which takes positive values. The age at death of the person aged X now is a random number of course, and it will be given by X plus Tx. The probability that Tx is smaller than or equal to t will be denoted by fxt for any t, and we will call that the lifetime distribution of x. 1 minus fxt is denoted by sxt, and that's the survival function of x. That's the sxt is the probability that the person of age x will still be alive in t years, so at the age x plus t. Now, here first a citation about future lifetimes. The first person to live for 1,000 years is possibly already alive, and those of us between age 20 and 30, there will be certainly some of them who will reach the age 130. This will have an instantaneous and catastrophic effect even on the world's population. And then there's a little story about the British king who had the idea to write, to send an anniversary message to the people turning 100. In 1917, King George V had to send 24 messages to centenarians. In 1952, there were 10 times more centenarians, namely 255. And in 2016, it had exploded to nearly 14,500. This is all about longevity, about the uncertainty, the risk related to longevity. So how long will a population live on average? Well, determining future longevity, that's essential for pension insurers, as we will see, but it's extremely difficult to manage that risk because of the systematic risk involved. An insurer is not so much interested in the individual survival or not of an individual insured, but of an insured population. And it is a known fact that populations over time live longer and longer thanks to better health conditions and so on. But how can you cope with that systematic risk as an insurer? This course will be partly about this problem. Now, let us consider again a person aged X, and let us denote his future lifetime Tx. But okay, also when he was born at age zero, of course, he had the remaining lifetime, and this was then T0. Also, he is now HX. If he survives until age Y, somewhere in the future, given that he then survives, he will have a random variable, we will attach a random variable of his remaining lifetime, then ty. And now the question is, what is in fact the relation between this ty, tx, and t0, or better, between the distribution of these random variables? The assumption that we will make is as follows. So x is the current age of the person. For any future age y and any t non-negative, we assume that the probability that the remaining lifetime of the y-year-old person will be smaller than or equal to t can be determined from the probabilities of survival at age zero, at birth. So this probability is the probability that the newborn will die before the age y plus t, because if ty is smaller than or equal to t, that means that he will die before the age y plus t. So we look here at the probability that the newborn will die before the age y plus t, but taking into account that the newborn lives until y. So we will assume that for any value y here, the distribution of ty follows from the distribution from the probabilities that we have given to survival to the newborn. So what is the interpretation of this assumption? The interpretation is as follows. Starting from the cumulative distribution function of t0, the only additional information used to determine survival probabilities at age x and beyond is survival or not. So we do not take over time, we do not take extra information except whether the person has died or survived. This may look a little bit strange because it's like at birth we give probabilities of survival, we never go to the doctor anymore to know our health condition to have better and better estimate of our survival probabilities. Two remarks on that. First of all, we are working here in an insurance context. We are looking at survival probabilities that are used by an insurer to set premiums for life insurance contracts. Moreover, here for simplicity, we always assume that we bring everything back to age zero, to age of birth, but in an insurance context, we will not do it in that way. We will bring every HY back to the beginning age of the insurance contract. So suppose that you underwrite the contract at age 30, we will bring any survival probabilities of remaining lifetimes at later ages back to the moment when you underwrote the contract. Why is an insurer doing that? So why is an insurer over time not taking more information than just that you survive or not? Well, assume that you underwrite a life insurance contract that pays you 100,000 euro when you die. At the moment that you underwrite the contract at age 30, the insurer determines the premiums that you will pay lifelong for that contract. Suppose now that 20 years later you have become 50, you're in very unhealthy condition, well, your life insurance should at that moment not increase the premiums because of the new information that you are now very unhealthy. Because life insurance is essentially about the fact that the ones who are lucky will pay for the ones who are unlucky. So the insurer is in a classical life insurance contract not allowed to change, to add more information about your health status over time, except of course that you are still alive. We will see that later also in detail. There is a corollary to this assumption 2.1, namely this one. Let t and u be non-negative, then we have the probability that tx plus t is smaller than or equal to u can always be written in terms of probabilities related to the remaining lifetime of x. So it's a conditional probability that tx is smaller than or equal to t plus u, given that tx is larger than t. So if we assume that every probability can be brought back to probabilities that were set at age of birth, we can also have that, in fact, any probability at a later age than x, any survival probability at an age later than x, can always be brought back to survival probabilities at the age of x. So probabilities at different ages are conditioned are connected by this conditional assumption. Now, let us say something about the connection between the lifetime distributions fx and f0. Well, you can prove that fxt is f0x plus t minus f0x divided by s0x. We will not give in this web lecture all the details about the derivations of these formulas. The derivation is not difficult, but the derivation can be found in detail in the book. So please have a look at the book and consider there the derivation of this and all the other formulas of which we do not see the derivation. It's very important, even if the exam is open book, it's very important that you have a look at all these derivations because it gives you a better understanding of the material. Survival functions sx and sx and s0 are also connected, and this formula 2.4 is a little bit more intuitive. S0x plus t is s0x multiplied by sxt. What does that mean? The probability that the newborn will live until the age x plus t is the probability that the newborn will live until the age x multiplied by the probability that the x-year-old person will live another 2 years. This is obvious. Probability of surviving until age x plus t is a probability of surviving until x multiplied by a conditional probability of surviving t years more, given that you survived until age x. And of course, our conditional assumption that we made on the previous slide is essential for this result to hold. So here we connect survival probabilities of a newborn with survival probabilities of an x-year-old person. But of course, it's the same person connected conditionally, as I said, with the assumption that we made before. And this connection can also be generalized for general ages x. The probability that x will still be alive in t plus u years is the probability that x will still be alive in t years multiplied by the probability that the x plus t year old person will still be alive in u years. Again, these derivations of 2.4 and 2.5, you can find them in the course text in the book. Please have a look there and be sure that you can make these derivations. Now we consider x, the status x, with future lifetime dx. What are the conditions for a function sxt to be a survival function? Well, here are the conditions. Sxt will be a survival function if and only if three conditions are satisfied. Sx0 is 1, or what does that mean? The probability that the person of each x who is alive now will still be alive now is of course 1. Condition 2 is the limit of sxt when we let t go to infinity is 0. That means everybody will die once, or the probability that x will still be alive in an infinite time from here is 0. And a third condition, sxt must be a non-increasing continuous function of t. Why does sxt has to be non-increasing? Of course, the probability that the person of each x will still be alive in 20 years is larger than that he will be still alive in 30 years. So sxt is a decumulative distribution function. These three conditions guarantee that we have to do with the survival function. Now, for all survival functions sxt in this course, we will make a number of additional assumptions. The assumptions that we will make are the following. The derivative with respect to t of sxt exists for all t. So we can always take the derivative of the survival function, or the survival function is sufficiently smooth. That's what we assume. Second assumption, the limit of t sxt where we let t go to infinity is 0. And assumption 3, the limit of t squared sxt for t going to plus infinity is also 0. Essentially, assumptions 2 and 3, these are technical conditions, but they ensure that the mean and the variance of the distribution function of dx exist. In this book, and they will also be mentioned in the presentation, there are a lot of examples that are worked out in detail. We will not, in this web lecture, go in detail to this, all these examples, but again, just as with the derivations of formulas, here for these examples, have a detailed look at it in the book and try to understand and to solve the questions that are asked there. This is very important as a preparation for the exam. So here in example 2.1, for instance, we give F0T, so the probability that a newborn will die before age T is given by this function. And once this function is given, you must be able to calculate different probabilities as mentioned here. Again, have a look at this in the book and try to solve this, to make these calculations. Now we introduce an important concept, namely the force of mortality. It sounds a little bit abstract, it is a little bit abstract at first sight, but it's a very helpful tool for setting models for survival. So we consider a person with survival function at birth given by this probability that T0 is larger than T for all T. And the force of mortality is then defined as follows. We calculate the probability that Tx is smaller than or equal to h, and we divide by h. And now we take h very small, we take h going to zero. So this interval over which x has to survive is made smaller and smaller, and we take the limit for h going to zero. And this is, by definition, this limit is called the force of mortality ux. Ux is the force of mortality at hx. We will give an interpretation of that concept in a while. Now we know already that the probability that tx is smaller than or equal to h, because of our assumption that we made, it can always be expressed as probabilities related to a newborn. So we rewrite this probability as the conditional probability that t0 is smaller than or equal to x plus h, given that t0 exceeds hx divided by h, and we take the limit for h going to zero, and that from for our time interval making smaller and smaller and going to zero, and that's our mu x. What is now the intuitive interpretation of mu x? Well, let us in 2.6 replace h has to become very small, let us make it a very small, infinitesimal interval dx. So let us replace h by dx and bring it to the other side. Then we get here mu x dx. And if we forget about the limit because our dx is very small, we get here the probability that t0 is smaller than x plus dx given t0 is larger than x. So what is the meaning of the force of mortality? Mu x dx is the probability that the newborn will die before the age x plus dx, given that he is still alive at time x. That's the intuitive interpretation of mu x dx. Or you can also say it in another way, mu x dx is the probability that the person of age x will die within an interval of length dx. Remember, this intuitive interpretation is very often that we will use it, and we will say this is the probability that, given that t0 is larger than x, that t0, that the person dies immediately after hx. So dying, surviving until hx, but then dying in the next infinitesimal interval, we will say dying immediately after hx. Remember that the mu x dx is a kind of conditional probability. Now we can have some other expressions for mu x. We can express mu x in terms of the survival function at birth. Mu x in terms of s0 can be written as minus mu x is minus 1 over s0 x multiplied by the derivative with respect to x of s0 x. The derivation is in the book, please have a look at it. Let us now have a look at the probability density function of tx. The probability density function we will denote is by fxt. That's of course the derivative with respect to t of the cumulative distribution function fxt, or because the survival function is 1 minus the cumulative distribution function, we can also write this in terms of survival function as minus ddt sxt. Taking into account what we have now just seen here, we can express mu x in terms of the density function at h0 and the survival function at h0. Indeed, the force of mortality at hx is the density function at time 0, the density function of the newborn at hx divided by the survival function of the newborn at hx, survival until hx. Now, let us now for a moment suppose that x is fixed. For instance, we consider a person of age 30 and the variable is now t. And let us now have a look at mu x plus t, so that's the force of mortality at hx plus t. Well, from what we have seen before, we can derive the following expression. The force of mortality at hx plus t is the density function of x at time t divided by the survival function of x in t. We can also interpret it in an intuitive way. Mu x plus t dt is in fact, intuitively, the conditional probability that x will die before time t plus dt, given that x is still alive at time t. So mu x plus t dt is the probability that x will die immediately after time t, given that he is still alive at time t. If you now look at expression 2.10, that is a formula that tells us if you know the survival function, if the survival function is given, then you can derive the force of mortality function, mu x plus t for all x. But let us now have a look at the other way around. Suppose that we know the survival function, all the mu's, what is the survival, that we know all the forces of mortality, mu x plus s, let us now try to calculate the probability that x is still alive at time t, so the survival function. This can be, you can prove this expression, because here, if you use integration on this expression here, you will get that the survival function is in fact an exponentially decreasing function, where the factor in the exponential function is minus integral between 0 and t mu x plus s ds. The mu's are always positive. The integral here, it is in the integrand, the area over which you integrate is increasing with t, so it's a decreasing function as wanted. So more or less intuitive, the survival function is a kind of exponentially decreasing function, as mentioned in 2.11. There is another example, example 2.2. Please have a look at it carefully. Now let us have a look at some particular laws of mortality. We will consider two important laws, the law of Gompertz and the law of Makem. In the law of Gompertz, we say that the force of mortality at hx is b multiplied by c to the power x, where b and c are constants, b is non-negative and c is larger than 1. So that means the force of mortality at hx is an exponentially increasing function of h. So remember again the meaning of mu x. Intuitively, mu x means, given that the person is still alive at hx, what is the probability that he will immediately die now? Well, this probability of immediately dying is an exponentially increasing function of h. That's the idea behind Humbert's law and seems to be quite intuitive. Makeham's law is an extension of Humbert's law. Here we have mu x, so given that the person is alive at hx, what is the probability that he now immediately will die? It's again this exponentially increasing term b, c to the power x, but there is also a constant added. So it's like, given that you reach hx, the probability of immediately dying is caused by two phenomena. The one is aging. The older you get, the more likely that you will die. But there is also an age-independent factor, just dying by chance, let's say, which is independent or equal for all ages. Now, both models, which are very often used in practice, provide a good fit to mortality data. Of course, not over all age ranges, as we will see more in detail later, but they perform well for middle age until early old age. For instance, for very young age, you have the infant mortality, a higher mortality at just the years after birth. You cannot see this. This cannot be observed in Humpert's or Meacham's law because they are just exponentially increasing. Or the mortality, the higher mortality of young people in the age between 18 and 22. You can also, of course, not observe this in Humpert's or Meacham's law because they are just exponentially increasing with age. Now there is an important example, example 2.3, where you, for Humpert's law of mortality as well as for Meacham's law of mortality, you have to derive an expression for the survival function, SXT. In case of Humpert's law, you have SXT. Remember, this is the probability that a person of age X will still be alive in 2 years, is an exponentially decreasing function, and the function is of this form. This follows, of course, from the expression we had for SXT as a function of the force of mortality, the one that we have seen some slides ago. Meacham's law of mortality has a very similar force of mortality, except that there is an extra term AT in the function of which we take the exponent. A small remark, this expression 2.12 is often rewritten in a little bit different way, as xt is s to the power t, g to the power c to the power x multiplied by c to the power t minus 1, where we have to define s as e to the power minus a and g as e to the power minus b divided by ln c. This formula, this expression follows, of course, immediately from 2.12. Then some more information, historical information about Humpert's and Meacham's laws. Benjamin Humpert's lived from 1779 until 1865. He was chief actuary at a company in England which was called Allianz Assurance Company. Important is that before Humpert's, demographers, so people who study survival and mortality, they collected already and they compiled mortality data and they used mortality data, but they never considered a formal law of mortality. So they were just using statistical data about mortality for different ages, but Humpert's was the first to try to find a formula for it, a formal law for it. He published his law of mortality in 1825 in the Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society of London, and here is an extract of the paper that he published. Now, Humpert's law performs a fairly good fit from middle ages 35 to old ages 90. For very old ages, it overestimates death rates, as we will see in the future also. Of course, it does not capture infant mortality, a higher mortality in very low ages, the first 8 years after birth, and also the accident hump, the higher mortality, especially for males in the age between 18 and 25, let's say. It's a remark is that he was Jew and very religious, and besides, he tried to combine his science with his religion in some sense. He said, neither profane history nor modern experience could contradict the possibility of the great age of the patriarchs of the scripture. So the patriarchs in the scripture lived very long. In fact, what he said, I have found a law such that the probability that you die becomes higher and higher with age, but it does not exclude the fact that people can live hundreds of years, or more than 100 years, or 150 years. Then a little bit more about the other law, the law of Meacham, but let's just start with the citation of Humpert's. Humpert's in 1825 said, in his paper, it is possible that that may be the consequence of two generally coexisting causes. The one is chance, without previous disposition to death or deterioration. The other is in fact deterioration or an increased inability to withstand destruction. So what he says here in words is in fact, maybe my law should be complemented, should be adapted. There is not only an increasing, exponentially increasing factor, there is also a constant factor. And that's exactly this, is exactly what not Humpert, but Makeham did. Makeham formalized and mathematized Humpert's law of mortality. And he published his law of mortality in 1860. And here is a small extract of this publication where he published his law of Makeham. This is the end of this first video.